everything is flowing in one way or another. Everything is going somewhere, growing, aging, and changing. The more we learn about the natural world, the more we see how different elements weave together and how many more connections become apparent. We've all heard of the balance of nature, and increasingly, we're starting to realize the need to live in balance with nature. Various terms have evolved: smart growth, green building, sustainable development, and now, the energy water nexus.
The energy water nexus is a term that refers to the connections between how we use energy and how we use water. To produce energy, we use a lot of water, and to pump and treat and transport water, we use a lot of energy. The most important thing really on both fronts is conservation. What it really means is that efficiency is the key. We need better energy efficiency to save not only energy, but to save water. And we need better water efficiency to save not only water, but also to save energy. And if you look at some of the initial studies, you can see that aggressive energy efficiency means water demand for energy use is flat. And aggressive water efficiency means energy demand for water use stays flat even as we grow.
One of the ways to do that is to design and incorporate conservation features into new developments and structures. This is called green building.
At Government Canyon State Natural Area, our buildings actually have a lot of green features that help us conserve energy. Everything from our large open-air exhibit gallery, which doesn't require air conditioning to keep it cool. It takes advantage of the prevailing breezes. Also, using solar power to power our pumps for our cisterns, that helps save us on electricity. Our large overhanging porches and eaves, they help naturally cool the building. We take advantage of prevailing indirect sunlight with north and south facing windows, so that way we can light up our buildings using indirect daylight and have less of a reliance on turning the light switch on.
For water conservation, the first step is to catch whatever rainwater falls from the sky.
Our rainwater harvesting system can help us capture almost 21,000 gallons of water. We try to be as conservative as possible about our water use, and we do that through a couple of things. One is we use low-flow toilets in our public restrooms. The other is our irrigation system is a drip irrigation system that irrigates native drought-tolerant plants. Because of that, we don't have to use very much water.
The choice of what materials a building is made of can also have an environmental impact.
Of course, one of the key ways to help reduce costs and to save energy and resources is to try and reduce, reuse, and recycle as much as we can. The piping that you see that creates the skeleton or framing for all of our buildings is actually recycled oil field pipe stem. And we've used locally quarried limestone in all of our fencing and the sides of the buildings. We've reclaimed eastern red cedar from a lot of the development that's been going on here in San Antonio. If you've been to San Antonio anytime recently, you know that they are building like gangbusters, and that means they're clearing a lot of land. Well, instead of just burning up some of that eastern red cedar that's so beautiful and so naturally resistant to rot and decay, we've harvested that and used that on the sidings of our buildings.
Our person on our website, we also have flyers that we put up here.
One of the most interesting aspects of our facilities here is that it serves as a demonstration and educational point for everyone who comes to visit us. We often get asked about our rainwater harvesting system, about our landscaping, about the materials that have been used in our buildings. And what I always enjoy telling people is, we're not really doing anything that you can't do at home.
As the Texas population grows, it's in homes where green building can have the greatest effect. For some home builders, it just makes good business sense.
Homes like this sell themselves. The need to save water, save energy, therefore save money, and live a healthier lifestyle is the easiest sales pitch I could think of. Our homes are built to extreme green building standards where they save over 50% of the traditional amount of power that it takes to power a traditional home. These are super insulated in such a way as even the entire attic is cool.
Here too, water conservation complements energy conservation.
The silliest thing we do is spend a bunch of time, money, effort treating water and then spraying it out on our lawns. The best thing we can do to conserve the big number is to capture rainwater and utilize that in our landscaping. Every home we build has the rain barrel at the bottom of the gutter. We use recycled wine barrels and turn them into a small cistern to collect water to water your flower beds. And then we also utilize low flow shower heads and fixtures, toilets, so forth.
Proper landscaping techniques also diminish the unnecessary wasting of precious water.
Well, you start with the base. You should have enough soil and the right kind of soil to hold enough water to where you only have to water your plants in your yard once a week if nature doesn't do it for you. And then having the indigenous plants that are used to the Texas climate and the Texas droughts and the Texas heat are exactly what you need to be putting in. They're beautiful as well. Everything we can do to save energy, save water, and be sustainable is no longer a fad, it's a necessity.
What we're seeing now on the food front, on the oil price front, on the water front, on many other issues is we have a lot of people on this planet. And to live together and leave a healthy planet to future generations, we have got to change the way we think about natural resources. We can't continue to waste them.
We all have a place in the public discourse about the future of our water. There is no doubt that the future of our water is one of the most defining natural resource issues that we will confront in the 21st century. And as we look to the basic questions, where is it going to come from, who's going to get it, and how much are they going to get, we need to show up and we need to be involved and we need to be educated and we need to make sure that our fish and wildlife are some of the beneficiaries of those decisions.
Mindsets are going to change as water supplies become more and more constrained. In the future, it's going to be flexibility, conservation, and a variety of sources. That's what's going to lead to certainty. The old ways have got to go.
The first thing we need to do as Texans is become educated and informed about all the issues surrounding our water. We need to know the source of our water. We need to know how to protect that water. We need to know how we can use that water as conservatively as possible to make sure that more water persists for future generations. We need to look to be active in our local communities to help protect our water quality and our water quantity. We need to help support organizations that are working to help conserve our water for fish and wildlife and people in our economies, but ultimately, we need to hold ourselves accountable for taking action to conserve water on an individual basis. At the end of the day, this is about a choice. And it's a choice that we as Texans will make to ensure that we have healthy, free-flowing rivers for generations to come. The beneficiaries will be our kids and their kids. It's a decision that I know that we'll get right.